President, please be seated. The court is now in session. Today, the chamber continues to hear testimony of the expert, Mr. Isa Osman. Ms. Chia Siu-Hua, please report the attendance of the parties and other individuals to today's proceedings. Gracias. Mr. President, for today's proceedings, all parties to this case are present. Except Mr. Kung Sum-on, the National Counsel for Kyu Sum-pon, who informs the chamber that he is absent for personal reasons. Mr. Nunji is present in the holding cell downstairs. He has waived his right to be present in the courtroom. The waiver has been delivered to the aggrieved. The witness who is to conclude his testimony today, that is Mr. Isa Osman and Ms. Julie Badesh, the OCIJ legal officer, are present in the courtroom. President, thank you, Ms. Chia Siu-Huang. The chamber now decides on the request by Nguyen Chia. The chamber has received a waiver from Nguyen Chia, dated 24 March 2016, which states that due to his health, that is, headache, back pain, he cannot sit or concentrate for long, and in order to effectively participate in future hearings, he requests to waive his rights to be present at the 24 March 2016 hearing. Having seen the medical report of Nguyen Chia by the duty doctor for the accused at the ECCC, dated 24 March 2016, which notes that today Nguyen Chia has back pain when he sits for long, and recommends that the chamber shall grant him his request so that he can follow the proceedings remotely from the holding cell downstairs. Based on the above information and pursuant to Rule 81.5 of the ECCC internal rules, the chamber grants Nguyen Chia his request to follow today's proceedings remotely from the holding cell downstairs via and audiovisual means. The chamber instructs the AV unit personnel to link the proceedings to the room downstairs so that Nguyen Chia can follow. That applies for the whole day. And before I hand the floor over to the defense team for Kyu Sum-pon to put further questions to the expert, the chamber will issue its oral ruling on co-prosecutor's request to call additional witnesses during the Phnom Krau Security Center trial segment, that is E390. The trial chamber is seized of a request by the co-prosecutors to call and hear the testimony from two additional individuals, two TCW-1017 and two TCCP-1016 for the Phnom Krau trial topic in case 002/02 pursuant to Internal Rule 87.4, document E390. The co-prosecutors argue that because three of the six witnesses and civil parties it proposed for this trial topic are now deceased, it is in the interest of justice to hear them. Having heard submissions of the parties on this request on Monday, 21st March 2016, and noting the requirements of Internal Rule 87.3 and 4, the Chamber decides to hear two TCCP 1016. This civil party will be heard next week for one day after two TCW 1012. Written reasons will follow in due course. A decision in relation to 2 TCW 1017 will be rendered as soon as possible. And I'd like now to hand the floor to the International Counsel for Kyu Sompon to put further questions to the expert, Mr. Issa Osman. You may proceed, Counsel.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Issa Osman. I would like to continue and pick up where we stopped yesterday. And with the leave of the President, I would like to provide a second folder to Mr. Issa Osman in order to allow him to avoid the problems that we faced yesterday. It's not going to cover all of the documents I'm going to mention, but at least it will cover some. And for the parties, the documents in question are E3/2653, E3/9323, E3/9500, E3/162. E3/7821 and E3/9307. I'd like to specify for the parties that the documents E3/9500 and E3/162 are only the first pages of the statements of both of these witnesses, and of course I cannot say their names publicly, and this to allow Mr. Osman to refer to the pseudonyms that will be listed on the first page of these statements only. So with your leave, Mr. President, may I give this binder to the expert?
Yes, you may.
Mr. Osman, yesterday we were speaking about two witnesses, Ahmad Sofia and Nosatas, whom you interviewed, and you mentioned them in Ukuba, and however, their accounts are in the Cham Rebellion. So one question regarding Ahmad Sofia and Nosatas: did you meet them once or several times when you were drafting your books?
But
good morning, Madam Counsel. From my recollection, I saw them more than one time. However, a detailed interview was conducted for one time only. And I'd like to clarify the last question you put to me yesterday. After I went home, I checked my book, and now I have a clear response for you. You asked me why Nosatas was with the number 40 rather than 100, and if you like, I can make that response. President, yes, if you have a better reference, then you may respond to the last question put to you by the Defense Counsel for Kyu Sompon. Expert. Thank you, Mr. President. In reference to my first book, that is Ukuba at page 6, I wrote that there are 6 people out of about 100 Cham people who survived And as for the rest, they disappeared. It means that they were all dead. In reference to Madame Usatas as arrested by the defense counsel, that she was one of those about 40 unmarried women. However, these 40 women were not the number of those women who were killed in Trier village, or that is, before they were arrested, detained, and killed. That was not the figure. The number 40 here referred to women who were gathered at Ksat Prochet Pagoda in Krochmar district. So that group of 40 women were gathered there. As for Ahmad Sophia's, that I referred to her, that she was one among those 100 who disappeared. I read her interview again, and she said that she was among the 35 women who were sent out of Wat Prachet Pagoda. However, in relation to the 100 or so women who died, I received that information through various interviews, namely from Mao Me Song, who told me that before the execution, there was not before they were sent to Ksat Prochet, but she was sent to a house located in Trier village. And they actually counted heads, and there were a total of 240. On the account of another woman that I also use as a reference, that is San Saro, she did not recall the exact number. And there is also another woman whom I refer to, is Saleh Saro. Who said that the number of people amongst those in the group that she made a journey with was about 200. So you can see the discrepancies in the number. Tam Chu actually is an alias for that woman, and she says that she was among the 50 who were sent out from Wat Prachet Pagoda. So we have different figures of 40, of 30, of 100 women, and they refer to the number of women who were sent out of Ksat Prochet Pagoda. As for the other figures, they refer to those people who were sent, that is a separate group, to another location, for example, out of the market at Krochmar district. So the different figures refer to different groups of women. And I made mention of about 100 figure, which is in between 40 and over 200. And Mr. Expert, if you recall the new question that was last put to you, you may respond. Answer, thank you, Mr. President. I was asked by the Defense Council how many times that I met Ahmad Sophia. Informally, I met her on several occasions, although I cannot recall the exact number. She lived in a village not far from my native village. However, for the purpose of my research for writing the book, I made a detailed interview with her, and later on I met her again to verify the record of that interview. And I recall that on another later occasion, I went to see her again because she does not live far from my native village.
So if I understood you well, with respect to Nosatas, you had one in-depth interview, and with Ahmed Sophia, you had one in-depth interview and another interview to confirm all of these statements. Am I correct?
But.
Yes. And I'd like to add that after I came to work for the Khmer Rouge Tribunal, in my capacity as an analyst for the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges, I went to see her again. And I went with an investigator, Mike Dixon. And actually, Mike Dixon had an excerpt from my book read out to her and requested her to make any changes. And later on, she provided her fingerprint on a copy from that book that she confirms that was her statement.
So, to finish off with this issue of figures, as you mentioned them in Ukuba, what you're saying is that you yourself came up with an average of the figures that were provided to you. But to be clear about this, because you spoke to me about people in the pagoda, people in the market, in the excerpt that I read out to you yesterday, that is to say document E3/1822, ERN in English 0007854, when you speak about these 100 people, you're saying at the beginning of the paragraph, and I will quote in English.
One example: in late 78, the Khmer Rouge gathered all those accused of crimes, both Cham and Khmer, into a house in three village. Donc, dans
so in this context, you're not speaking about the pagoda, you're not speaking about the market, you're speaking about the house in Tria village. So my question is, the approximate figure and the average you came up with of 100 Cham, you are the one who came up with this figure, but do we agree that this figure is connected to the house in Tria village?
Reference to the figure of 100 that is used in my book. I actually did not use the figure 100 in the bracket, for the professional work in the research. When the words are put in bracket, it means that refer to the actual words of a witness without any modification by the researcher. However, the figure 100 in my book is not put in a bracket, so it is not the exact word of a witness, and that is. The figure is based on my research with the five witnesses, including Nosatas, Ahmad, Sophia's, and three other women. And that is due to the different figures given to me by various witnesses.
Please forgive me for interrupting, but I did understand. I believe that I mentioned this in my question, but my question was different. So do we agree that this figure relates to the house in Tria village? Is that, that is my question. Is this figure connected to the house in Tria village?
That figure of 100 is in reference to an event of unmarried women who were sent, who were arrested and sent to Tria village, and that later on they were purged. Those women were interrogated before they were killed. They were asked whether they were a charmed or Khmer. However, there were other instances of the events that I referred to.
Excusez-moi.
I apologize, but I'm really trying to put to you specific questions given the short amount of time that is given to me. So please try to answer as precisely as possible. So you confirmed, yes, that indeed that figure was connected to that house in Trier where there were unmarried women. So thank you for this clarification. In your interviews with Nosatas, we know that when she was interviewed on 10 June 2000, which resulted in a DCCAM record document E39307, we know that Nosatas explained to you that she personally attended an execution, and but before the co-investigating judges, and I believe you were there, she said that she was not an eyewitness of this execution. And to explain why she had lied regarding the fact of having seen an execution, she said that she wanted justice to be done. So my question is going to focus more generally speaking on this fact of when you interview people who have experienced traumatizing events and people who are requesting justice. So psychologically speaking, isn't there a risk that sometimes the statements or the accounts that you gather, and I'm speaking here specifically about Ukuba and the Cham Rebellion, isn't there a risk that sometimes the information that you gather is not accurate and does not correspond to the totality of the facts? Or maybe what is said might be mixed up with what other people have said. So is this something that you thought about when you were writing your books?
I acknowledge that for some witnesses, when I first interviewed them, they spoke on one account, and later on they spoke rather differently on a separate account. Although they are not completely different, but there are some differences in the accounts, and I believe that is due to the passage of time and their recollection of what happened. As I stated yesterday, if Nosatas is to be interviewed in 10 years' time, the accounts that she recalls might be different from what she told me during my interview with her. And of course, when an investigator from OCIJ interviewed her, I was present there, and that is the purpose that we asked her to verify her account that I used in my book. And of course, we preserve the actual statement or interview of witnesses, and that we do not make any alteration.
Ma question était un petit peu différente.
My question was somewhat different. I do understand that with time, statements may change. But regarding the explanation Dr. Nosatas gave, I'm referring you to his statement before the OCIJ, E3/5193, ERN in French, 00224113, ERN in English, 00274704, and ERN in Khmer, 00204445. And it continues on the next page. And this is what is stated in that statement. I told Mr. Osman that I had sent those executions because I wanted to make sure that justice was rendered to me in the wake of what those murderers had done. He's not saying that he gave erroneous information. She said that she said things she hadn't witnessed with her own eyes because she needed to have justice delivered. My question to you is as follows. As part of your interviews, did you have the impression that people like Nosatas could provide information on events that they hadn't witnessed with their own eyes or erroneous information because they needed to have justice done? Is that something you took into account as part of your research or not?
As a victim, they feel the pain for the loss of their parents or family members, in particular if they witness the execution of their parents or family members. And of course, I believe there might be some extra words used by witnesses. And of course, I preserve the integrity of the statement of the interview. If a witness says that she witnessed an event, that is what I would write in the record. I will not add or remove any part of the interview or the statement. And of course, I had the same feeling as you just put to me. A victim would want to see justice being done. And sometimes the words that they use will be a little bit more than what actually happened. And witnesses refer to the killings, and of course the killings did take place. That's why they lost their family members and parents, and that's why hundreds of thousands of young people perished during the regime.
Sur la question du village du Tri.
As regards the question concerning Tree Village, did you find out who were the local officials at the time, particularly who was the district secretary? We have heard a number of witnesses testify before this chamber, and I must say that the issue of the Krochma district head is still a mystery to me. Did you carry out any research on that subject?
Answer. Tree Village was under the control of Krochma district. The first committee of that district from 1975 was Tapa. Tapa came from Dambai district. He was reassigned to be in charge of Krochma district. However, later on, he was killed, perhaps in early 1977, when the purge started to happen in the East Zone. Tapa and other cadres were purged in Krochma district. And after Tapa, there was another individual, the close associate of Gai Bo, and that person was also related to Gai Bo. That individual was transferred from Chamka Le, the central zone, to be in charge of Krochma district. That individual's name was Ta Ho. In the interviews that I got in relation to the killings of Cham people in 1977 and 78, interviewee knew well Ta Ho. Now Ta Ho changes his name. He was trying to conceal his background, his actual activities in relation to the killings, and also he wanted to conceal his responsibility. I am working in the OCIJ. I had chance to see him, and I could say that he lies 100% of what he knew.
Je pose cette question aussi parce que à un moment
I put this question to you also because at a point in time you referred to Saleh Samath's account in your book, and you talk about a trip on which he went on a motorbike with the district head to attend a meeting. And when he is questioned on the district head, he said that the district head is deceased. My question to you is as follows. Are we talking of the same district head as the infamous Ho? Because at the time you referred to Saleh Samath's account, there was another district head in office.
Answer. Those who could recollect what happened during the time, particularly in relation to the committees of the district. The district committee consisted of three people. The first one was the secretary, and the second one was the deputy secretary, and the last one was a member. Some people may have confused by saying that the deputy secretary was the district chief. And this also happens to the third individual in that committee. The member might have been confused that he or she was the chief of the district. Tapa, as I said, deceased. Tapa was killed after the south, the central zone and the southwest zone entered that place.
Je reviendrai éventuellement.
I will eventually revisit that point later. I'd like us to press on and talk about your work. Yesterday, it appears that you stated yesterday that you had observed that things were said by persons you interviewed and that there were changes in terms of responsibilities. As part of your work and as part of your research, did you systematically meet people, or was it only when you had in-depth interviews that you met with persons?
Thank you. answer for those who did not live far away from my birth village. Most of the time, frequently, I passed those people, villages, and I went to interview some of them on a few occasions, and that the interviews that I conducted happened in 2006, so it almost 10 years ago. For interviewees who were living in far places, I met them only on one occasion, and I cannot tell you whom I met on several occasions and whom I met only on one occasion.
Je voudrais maintenant.
I would like us to talk about the documentary research you carried out on the contemporaneous documents at the time and documents prior to the Democratic Cambodia period. In answer to questions put to you by the co-prosecutor, you stated that as regards the number of charm in 1974 in Democratic Cambodia, you had chosen not to carry out any research on the census that was carried out by the French in the previous period. If I properly understood your testimony, and I stand corrected if I am wrong, you said that you were of the view that, generally speaking, that census was not reliable because you had met a witness who had worked in a plantation run by the French, and that one day some people came to interview people working at that plantation, and that they hadn't made any distinction between Khmer and Cham workers. Did I properly understand that that was the reason why you were of the view that the census conducted by the French was not reliable? And for purposes of completeness, in the interest of the chamber and the parties, I'm referring to an article in Phnom Penh Post document E3/9680, which only exists in English. The ERN is 01199557.
Looks right. Answer, Madam Counsel. I believe in what Cham people I interviewed told me. They said they have never seen actual consensus was conducted. I do not need to go back into the past. After I was born and after 1979, the government did not conduct any census in relation to Cham people. To know how many people living in a village, the government needs to conduct a survey in that entire village without discriminating Khmer people from other ethnicities. And in the ID card that I hold, it says only Cambodian nationality. It does not state Cham Muslim in that ID card. So this is what happening in this period, and that is true also in the past regime. If you want to make sure whether I am saying it's true or not, you can go to ask the government officials about that.
Vous avez indiqué que vous n'avez pas fait.
You stated that you did not carry out any research on the census. My question to you is as follows: without having carried out any research on the French census, did you know what methods were used at the time while you were doing your research? For instance, did you go to libraries and did you consult archives to look at documents relating to that census, as Ben Kiernan was able to do? Did you yourself carry out such research? I understand that you considered that that census was not reliable, but did you yourself do anything, carry out any research to know how the census was carried out, under what circumstances, and so on and so forth?
Answer. I stand by the what I said. The interviews that I got from the interviewees did not make mention about the consensus conducted or carried it out in the past regimes. For this reason, I did not focus on carrying the research on whether consensus was conducted. The figure that I had, was quoted from one individual I trust. That individual worked with those who were in charge of managing the entire Cham people in Songkum Rinayum and in later regime. His name was Les Loss. The top leader of a Cham community was known as Chang Wang, or chief, and they had hakims, as I testified before this chamber, about the roles and functions of hakim. Hakim was in charge of Cham people in villages. In one village, there is an hakim, and hakim makes the reports to the superior of how many Cham people is living in particular village. So the reports from those hakims in respective villages, after the addition of that the statistic, we got the number. Let last, I have met him, and he said, I met as Adam, that Adam worked closely with Les Loss, and then he the one who gave me the statistic of Cham people living in the past regimes.
Vous évoquez des statistiques.
You refer to statistics that were drawn up during the previous regime and reports produced during that previous regime. Are these documents you consulted, or these are things that were told by the people you interviewed? Did you consult those documents apart from the oral interviews you conducted?
Answer. The figure that you mentioned came from the assertion of interviewees I met. Whether that figure was within the documents from the past, I believe that figure was from those documents based on scientific research. Those documents may have destroyed and burned by the Khmer Rouge. And when the question is put to me, where I got the figure from and those documents were destroyed by the Khmer Rouge, I cannot find those documents. And I can put this question back. So why Khmer Rouge destroyed those documents and then put this question to me?
Moi, je suis pas là pour répondre aux questions. Je suis là.
I am unable to answer that question. When you talked of statistics and reports, I wanted to be sure that your information stemmed from what you were told orally. So my question to you is as follows. I have indeed understood that you interview persons you trusted. Now I would like to know, in terms of your scientific research methodologies, wasn't it logical as part of an empirical research, which you considered rigorous, to consult all documents that existed on the subject, including the French census that was carried out at the time? Did you consult those documents to find that they were unreliable? What was missing in those documents? Or did you just rely on the testimonies given by your interviewees? And in which case, wouldn't that be unempirical in terms of the scientific research methodologies used?
But if you do not believe in what my witnesses or interviewees told and relied on French census, I want you to show me the specific figure, particularly the population of Cham people in that time, president. And you are an expert witness. You are obliged to respond to the questions put to you based on your realm of knowledge and expertise. And by answering the questions, it can reflect how the in-depth analysis you have done in your research and then published in your book. If you do not know the answer, you can say so. Secondly, you cannot provide any information based on the activities that you have done while working in the OCIJ. You are here to testify as an expert witness. You cannot direct the chamber or any judicial officers to find other evidence. So you are here to testify your research and field of expertise. And questions are now put by the defense team for the accused. They have different styles of questioning methods. They may have questions to cross-examine you so that the information you testify is reliable. So you will have to answer about your expertise and your knowledge. So please do not go beyond what is, it is not within your expertise. If you expand beyond out of your expertise, so it's not useful for the chamber. And I can say that some of your answers may in turn incriminate or put weights on you or put pressure on you, and then may lead to extensive time of questioning. Do you understand that, Mr. Expert Witness?
But
Witness, thank you, Mr. President. I understand it. I apologize when I expand beyond my expertise. However, I am repeatedly testifying before this chamber, and counsel may not have believed what I said. That is why I am forced to expand further beyond that, beyond my expertise. And for instance, about the French census, and I do not I cannot find any other answers to respond to the question put by Council President. Whether parties believe it or not, it's not the matter. But you are here to tell the Chamber, and later on the Chamber will assess, will analyze the value of your testimony. And you have to tell the Chamber about what you have known and about your expertise, and after that the Chamber will analyze that value of your testimony. You are now telling the Chamber, not the party. You are answering questions of the party, but you are here to tell the Chamber. So the people who come to testify before the Chamber has to have to answer to the Chamber, not to parties.
Je vais peut-être du coup répéter ma question.
I may have to repeat my question so that you should understand correctly. We have looked at the publications of different writers and authors. I'm interested in your scientific approach in your research. And in that regard, my question to you is as follows. Don't you find that it is a shortcut which adversely affects your reflections and your methods? The fact that you did not look at all the documents that existed on the census that was carried out. Aren't you being somewhat non-objective in doing so? You yourself chose not to carry out any research on that issue. And my question, once again, is as follows. Is it not something that impedes your reflections, that obstructs your reflections?
Answer. My research was done based on my capacity and my ability. I have met survivors, witnesses, and I did not meet the deceased witnesses. I do not have the ability to spend to fly abroad to France to ask about the statistic or census in France.
Est-ce que dans le cadre
as part of your research at DCCAM, did you sometimes have to write to resource persons, not necessarily those in Cambodia, to ask them to provide information on what they knew? You said that you were able to speak to some authors who worked on certain documents. As part of your research, was the exchange of documentation between you and those persons? I understand that you were not able to go to France to obtain the required documents. Didn't you have other means while you were working at DCCAM to obtain documents from other persons who worked on those subjects, for instance?
Answer. I have known authors of books in relation to Khmer Rouge, and I have communicated with them via emails. And I do not completely refer or based on the information from those authors' books. They have met, I mean the author of those books from America, from other country, have met the witnesses, but they cannot speak Cham language. For me, I can speak Cham language, so I can meet them and conduct the interviews in detail them then.
Well, then I'm going to turn to another point. So regarding this discussion on the census and the number of Cham who were present in Cambodia in 1974 at least, and regarding the work that was done on this issue and that formed the subject of various reports before this chamber, did you ever, for example, see Eva Tabo's demographic expert report, document E3/2413? Are you aware of this document? And especially, do you have the technical knowledge to understand the demographic formula that are explained in detail in this report? You don't have to provide me with a long answer, but simply, are you aware of this document and are you able to analyze this document? If not, well, then we will just proceed.
Answer, I have never read that document.
You worked specifically on the Cham under the DK regime. So when you started your work, did you start doing generic research on the DK policies in general terms based on documents from the period? Did you do this prior to your field research with your interviews that you conducted with the witnesses that you interviewed? So is this kind of research you did prior to your interviews, or did you do that kind of research after when you were writing your book?
In reference to my first book, I read documents from two slides, namely confessions, reports, and telegrams. These documents were maintained at the DCK office. I also read those documents in relation to the Cham people who were arrested and sent to S21. I also went to see the surviving family members of those who were arrested and sent to S21, and they confirmed about the loss of their family members. This is my process dealing with the first book. As for the second book, I did not have many written resources to rely upon. However, I relied on the telegram about the evacuation of Cham people from the East Zone in late 75, as it is related to the evacuation of the Cham people after the suppression of the rebellion. I relied rather heavily for my second book on the interviews I conducted with the victims, some of whom participated in the rebellious activities and survived, as well as interviews with a few of the perpetrators who used to work at the Kruchma District Security Center.
In particular, you spoke about the Cham being sent to different places. So in the context of that research, Did you focus on population transfers in general? Because this is what we saw in case 0021 and a little bit as well in this case. There were various population transfers that involved the entire population in Democratic Kampuchea and not only the Cham. So my question is, were you able to conduct research on these population transfers in general terms to see if the Cham were involved in this general process or not?
I interviewed people who were evacuated, and that evacuation did not take place in 1975 based on the accounts of those people. Some of them were actually evacuated in 1973, that is during the clashes between the Khmer Rouge troops and the Lunar troops. As Khmer Rouge actually relocated them from the clashes area to another location. And the second evacuation happened after the fall of Phnom Penh as well as the fall of other cities. That is on the 17th April 1975. They were evacuated out of the cities and they were considered new people, and that they did not support their policies from the beginning. So those peoples were evacuated from Phnom Penh to provinces, including the Cham people. And another evacuation took place in around November or December 1975. And that was particularly for the Cham people in Klochma district, Kong Mi, Bong Khmum. And that happened in the East Zone as well as the Old North Zone. And through my research, only the Cham people were evacuated at that stage as they were involved in the rebellion. So the Khmer Rouge would not allow the Cham people to live in as a community in order to avoid any further rebellion. For that reason, they were evacuated. And this does not mean that they were evacuated to an area where Cham people were living. In fact, they were evacuated and dispersed through various villages to live, mingled with the Khmer people. For example, two or three Cham families were evacuated to live in a village with the Khmer people. And the plan was to disperse them or not to allow them to live in a community so that they would be the subject of monitors. President, thank you. And Mr. Expert, you are reminded to respond rather precisely to the question. In particular, the last question, that is in terms of your research, whether your research focuses only on the evacuation of the Cham people or on the evacuation of other people, including the Cham, the Khmer, and the Chinese. And that is the nature of that question. So you should actually limit your response to that. And if you expand your response, it may overlap with the subsequent questions that the Council may put to you. And Council, you may continue.
Thank you. Now, in response to your last lengthy response, you said that you noted in your interviews that the population transfers only involved the Cham in the third phase of population transfers that you spoke about. But in your interviews, did you interview other people than Cham people, that is to say, Khmer people from the same place, in order to see if they were also transferred during that same period? Did you speak to other people other than Cham people?
Yes, I did. And they confirmed that the Cham people who were living in the next village were being evacuated.
Can you give us an idea, a range, of the number of people you spoke to? So you're telling to me about Cham people from the next door village. So in which village did you interview these people?
Cannot provide you the figure based on my recollection, since it happened several years ago. And those people that I interviewed were living within the same commune next to that village. And I recall one name, Chum Kia, whom I interviewed. I also recall another name, Din Pait. And there were also other people whom I interviewed.
Mr. President, maybe it's a good time to have the break.
Thank you, Counselor. It is now convenient for a short break. We'll take a break now and resume at 10:30. Court officer, please assist the expert during the break time and invite him, as well as the OCIJ legal officer, back into the courtroom at 10:30. The court is now in recess.